prayer today. We just want to take a moment in light of what's happened this weekend in downtown and say a prayer for those who've been affected by this mass shooting. Heavenly Father, we do pray right now for those who are in the hospital, those who are recovering, those whose loved ones are suffering because of this shooting on Friday night in downtown. God, we pray for law enforcement, the first responders. Thank you for their efforts in saving, rescuing lives that no one has passed away. And God, for those who did this, unfortunately, there are just two people of many across our country that resort to violence. God, there's a soul sickness within our nation where people want to take others out before taking their own life. God, we just pray for healing. We just pray for a renewing in hearts. And God, would you use us to reach out and to love and to serve those who are hurting? So God, we just thank you ultimately that we can entrust our lives to you and that today's a new day. And so God, in that spirit, we just ask that you would speak to us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're so glad that you're here today, and today is a new day. Today we can celebrate life and all that God has for us. Even if you're not yet sure about God and you're just checking things out, I want to encourage you to try something. Just go all in. Just get rid of all the distractions and really fully engage in order to help us connect our hearts to God. Why don't we stand up together and let's sing these songs.
The shadow where I hide, the rest. talking about trust in this series, and often trust can be the most difficult posture to take, especially when that is concerning other people and God. And we want to invite you to think of a concept that God is someone who can immeasurably give us more than we could ever hope for and ever imagine, and that includes working miracles in our own hearts to heal and to be able to trust Him and trust others again. And so while we sing this next song, think about the fact that there is a God that works miracles over and over again.
You have never failed me.
much that you are a miracle worker in and through our lives, and that you can give us the understanding that we can trust you. Thank you for all you've done. We just ask for understanding of your character that loves us unconditionally and wants us to be able to trust you. In your name, Jesus, amen. Thank you all for singing with us. You may be seated.
Hey, what's up? My name is Ross, and the weird quirk I have is that I can't finish the last little bit of anything. Like toothpaste in the tube, peanut butter in the jar, drinks. This has a little bit of coffee left in it. It's still hot. Doesn't matter. I'm going to dump it out anyway. I cannot finish the last little bit of anything. It's weird, I know.
My name's Emily, and one weird quirk I have is when I can't sleep at night, I repeat the alphabet backwards in my head. ZYXWVUTSRQPONMLKJIHGFEDCBA.
My name is Justin, and one of my many weird quirks is I can touch my tongue to my uvula.
Hey, my name is John, and one of my weird quirks is I love to sit on the couch and play with my dog's hair. He loves it.
Hi, my name is Jeff, and one weird habit I have is I always use a fork to scoop my butter so that the surface is always smooth.
Hey y'all, my name is Tara, and one of the strangest things I do is that I'm constantly trying to fit my husband's name into every song there is. R-E-S-U-B-E-N-P-T-R-E, find out what he means to me.
My name is Paul, and I have a really weird quirk, and I like to go to my friends and make really high-pitched fart noises, like this.
All right, we have a great team, an odd team. But a great team. I love working with them. I thought I'd share my odd skill with you. Any of you know breakdancing very well? You know the centipede? I can do the centipede. Okay, you guys ready for this? You know, I'm not going to do it. It'll make our insurance go up. How about a little free sample? Just a little. They're a little pop and lock, right? If you want to see more, you can just go to my TikTok. Actually, I don't have TikTok. The Carlos Ortiz does. It's true. He really does. But it's really wonderful to be part of a team that is genuinely trying to grow to become who God wants them to be and to help all of us grow to become who God wants us to be. But it's not always true in every scenario. Some of us here have been victims of really terrible treatment by church leaders. There's actually a book out about post-traumatic church syndrome by Reba Riley, in which she talks about people who've been treated poorly in church actually develop, it's almost like allergic reaction to anything spiritual. They end up struggling with anxiety, depression, moral confusion, grief, loss of identity. See, some of us may have been at a time of our life connected with God, but we walked away because of the evil choices of church leaders. Misusing funds or dishonest or illegal or immoral activities. Some of us have issues with God stemming from people who claim to be Christians who mistreated us. People who were in authority over our life that were not anything like Jesus, even though they claimed to follow him. And when we suffer from unhealthy leadership in our lives, sometimes we can find ourselves blaming God. We think to ourselves, doesn't God want me to be happy? Then why would he allow this to happen? See, we all have bosses and professors and parents and leaders in our life who have let us down. I mean, think about this. Even at an early age, we bristle against the idea of authority. Have you or your kids ever said, you're not the boss of me? You ever heard that? I mean, think about that. We're Texans. We don't want anyone to tell us what to do and when to do it, right? There's something inside of us that bristles at this idea. But here's the truth. Some of us have trauma and trust issues because of bad leadership. Some of us have trauma and trust issues because we've been in leadership. Being a leader can be incredibly difficult and even lonely. But here's the problem. Because of our trauma at the hands of others, those new to our life have to jump over hurdles And so today we're looking at overcoming trust issues, and maybe we should first rearrange and put leadership in its proper category. See, leadership is not an identity. It's actually a role or a function. Your job or your career is not your identity. See, a leader or pastor, father, husband is not who I am. Now, this is very countercultural, so listen closely. If you are a follower of Jesus, then your identity is actually in Christ. 216 times in the New Testament, that phrase, in Christ, is used to describe us, those of us who follow Jesus. What does that mean? It means all the love that we need, the value, the worth, the purpose that we need, we can find in our relationship with God. And you and I are to be a reflection of the image of Jesus in our homes and where we work and in our neighborhood. But too often we compartmentalize our lives. We have this great time with God in the morning, and then we go off to the work day as if we didn't even believe in God, forgetting all about it. Or we come on a Sunday morning and it's like we clock in and then clock out as we leave. But instead of compartmentalized lives, God is with us wherever we go. In fact, the scriptures say this in Joshua 1:9, the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Or in Deuteronomy 31, the Lord your God goes with you. We need to realize that God is with us everywhere, no longer compartmentalizing our lives, but being authentically his everywhere we go. Now, it's important when it comes to the role of leadership, we need to separate the person from the role. See, otherwise we start to see leadership as personal. We start to see decisions made as against us. And leaders will get it right sometimes, but they'll also get it wrong. And whatever the outcome, leadership decisions no longer have to be taken as personal victories or personal attacks when we separate the person from the role. It helps us not to pin all people who fill the role of leadership as toxic or damaging. Do leaders make poor choices? Absolutely. Way too often. Many horrific things have happened and been done by people in leadership. See, leadership is about power and influence and making decisions. And sometimes we rally around decisions that we like, and other times we vehemently oppose decisions leaders make. But see, leaders who are good from the inside out are leaders who are not dependent upon their leadership to define them. So with that, there can never really be a good or bad leader, but just good or bad people who take on the role of leader in our life. There's an article that came out this week called, Here's How to Tell Within 5 Minutes If Someone Will Be a Good Leader. Wonder if you're a good leader? Let me just read some of these. And if you can honestly say, yes, this is true of me, often or almost always, then you are a good leader. Just a few of them. First, I trust my workers. Next, I allow my workers to help determine where our team is headed. I am trustworthy. I give my workers the power to make important decisions. I provide the support and resources needed to help my workers meet their goals. I am open to receiving criticism and challenge from others. I use my power and authority to benefit my workers. See, what we hear in this list is this five-letter word, this elusive idea that we're talking about all month, and that is trust. To be a good leader, to be a good employee requires being trustworthy and learning how to trust. But I want to turn things upside down a little bit. It's very easy to spot a bad leader or a bad employee. It's easy to see the wrong things that they do or say. But I want you to do something different. I want you to start thinking in terms of a spiritual perspective when it comes to work. What if God allowed that difficult person into your life to help you become a better person? Is it possible that there's something you're supposed to learn in this difficult season? If you're in conflict at work, if you have a terrible boss, or you have an employee you just can't fully understand. I want to look at a story from the scriptures, one of my favorite, it's Joseph. And many of you might know the story of Joseph from the Broadway play, Joseph and his Technicolor Dreamcoat. Let me just help you a little bit and give you a few more of the real story details, which are far more raw and salacious and unjust and redemptive. See, Joseph was one of 12 brothers, and yet his father favored him more than all the others. And we know that because he gave him a coat. See, typically in big families, all you get is hand-me-downs, right? But in this family, he got this beautiful coat, and his brothers became very jealous of him. And as a result, some of them wanted to kill him. But a few of the brothers convinced the others, let's not kill him. And instead, they sold him into slavery. I guess that's better. But then he ends up in Potiphar's house, and he ends up in charge. He's an enslaved man in the foreign country of Egypt, but he's got all these great responsibilities only to have Potiphar's wife start making moves on him. And so he runs away. He gives us great advice on what to do when you face sexual temptation. Run. Just get out of there. Eventually, he's caught and they throw him in prison. He went from slave to now in prison in Egypt. And while there, two of the other prisoners came to him with dreams, and he was able to interpret these dreams. One of the guys gets out and forgets all about Joseph. 2 years go by, and the Pharaoh has a dream, and he remembers Joseph in prison. They bring Joseph out, and he explains the meaning of Pharaoh's dream. He says, we're going to have 7 years, a bountiful harvest, followed by 7 years of famine. You need to prepare now for what's to come. And so the Pharaoh puts Joseph in charge of everything. Think about that. He went from enslaved to imprisoned to now governor of all of Egypt. Quite a promotion. And then his brothers show up needing help. Can you imagine? And he ends up testing them over the course of several conversations and eventually revealing himself to them with incredible joy and rescuing his family from the famine. It's an incredible story, and there are 5 principles I want to draw from it. First is, remember why you're there. See, Joseph had this vivid dream as a child that he would one day be the rescuer of his family. In fact, his family would bow down to him. And so when he was thrown into a pit and eventually sold into slavery, I'm sure he remembered, but wait a minute, God, I thought I was one day going to be a hero. And then when he was thrown into prison, I'm sure he went back to grab hold of that dream given to him by God. Wait a minute, God, I thought one day I'd be a hero. See, he never gave up the vision that God had given him. He never gave up on the purpose that God had given him, no matter where he may have found himself. See, if you're a temp or CEO or somewhere in between, you need to remember the proper perspective. If you're a follower of Jesus, you're actually working for God, wherever you may be. Now, we talked last month about certainly when you work, you're able to provide for your family. We talked about this idea of a healthy financial situation is when you give the first 10% to God, and the next 10% you invest in your future self in savings, and then you live on 80%. And if you can grow in that, you can actually increase your giving and increase what you're saving and investing in the future and live on less and less. But it's far more than a paycheck. There's a book out called Dying for a Paycheck. And in it, Jeffrey Pfeffer talks about improving employee health and well-being at work. And he says this, what is measured gets attention. What is not measured often gets ignored. Now, this is a wonderful way to remind us. Are you measuring, if you're a leader, are you measuring employee health and well-being? Are you just looking at all the numbers? But I want us to use this idea when it comes to our relationship with God. Are you measuring work in terms of your relationship with God? How many days this last week could you end the day knowing that you lived a life that would please God? You honored God in how you treated other people. What if we began to measure the level of how well we represent Jesus at work? Paul, a church planner who started multi-ethnic churches all across the Roman Empire, wrote a letter to the church he started in Colossae, and he says this, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as working for the Lord, not for human masters, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ you are serving. Notice how he changes their perspective. No matter what you're doing, you are working for God. You represent him there. Now, he uses this phrase, human masters. And I know some of us here are still kind of new to the Bible, or maybe we avoid the Bible. We think it's ancient, it's out of date, it's not really applicable to life. And this may be one of the examples. It talks about slavery. But the Bible is not pro-slavery. There's a great podcast called The Bible Project. They have a great website as well. And they use this I think, a wonderful analogy to help us understand how we should approach the scriptures. It's a cross-cultural experience across time and space, right? In many ways, we should come to the scriptures like a tourist. You know the worst kind of tourists? Those are the tourists that show up in a country and they think everything in that country is wrong. In their arrogance, they think that what I do in my culture is right and what you do in your culture is just wrong. The best tourists are those that show up with an open mind. They have no assumptions. They want to learn. See, when we go to the scriptures as a tourist, we're coming wanting to understand. If there's something we read, all we got to do is dive a little bit deeper to understand the cultural context. And in this case, Paul is writing in a time when 80% of the Roman world was enslaved. In fact, a higher percentage of the church was enslaved. So he's actually writing to slaves as if they're people, not property. He's addressing them. Here's how you should live in this moment. He later writes about freeing the slave in the story of Philemon, talking about freedom. See, slavery 2,000 years ago in the Roman Empire in that day and age was very different than what we think of in terms of the slavery experience in our country, in the United States, which was race-based chattel slavery. This was actually a way to get out of debt. In fact, if you were a slave to a Hebrew family, on the seventh day, you were freed in order to honor the Sabbath. And every 7 years, your debt was completely forgiven, and you were now free. You could choose to be a slave to pay off your debts. See, the early church leaders knew that once people began to experience spiritual freedom, eventually physical freedom would come. Enslavement was going to come to an end. See, in that culture, Paul was saying, even if you're in the worst situation in the world, you can trust God. You can work for him. He sees your efforts. He will reward you based on how you treat those in your life. The second thing we can learn from Joseph's story is redefine success. See, Joseph was a victim of jealous brothers and a false accusation from his boss's randy wife. See, even still, the scriptures reminded us that the Lord was with him and caused everything he did to succeed. Now, doesn't that sound great? Don't you want something to be written about you like that? He was successful in whatever he did. She was successful in everything she tried. That doesn't actually make sense, though, when you're talking about Joseph, does it? I mean, he was enslaved. He was imprisoned, falsely accused. See, what's happening here is something much bigger, a different understanding of success. See, many of us get disappointed in God because we think, if I just promise God to do better, then he will give me success. But success, according to our definition, is it's the opposite of failure. It's the absence of hardship. We define success in our dictionary as the attainment of wealth, position, honors, or the like. But the biblical understanding of success is very different. It's a word that means to be prudent, circumspect, wisely understand and prosper. In other words, according to God, success means making wise choices regardless of the circumstances. See, he was successful. He made wise choices every step of the way, no matter how difficult things went for him. See, trusting God, even when circumstances might make you think you shouldn't, that's what it means to be successful in the eyes of God. See, our mission, just like Joseph's mission, is to discover life and freedom with God and then bring that life and freedom to those around us. Joseph chose to commit himself to God and his decisions to God, and as a result, he experienced the blessing of God, the presence of God, even in the darkest of moments. Number three, we should seek to find the good. I want you to think for just a moment. I want you to pause and reflect on this idea. God is doing something in your life. Do you sense it? Do you realize it? I mean, think about all that you've survived over this last year and a half. Think of God's protection, even provision. Some of us are doing better in our relationships and at work now than we ever have been. Others of us, it's been incredibly difficult, but you've made it here now. Do you sense, do you see the good that God is doing in your life, the good that he wants to do? He may be allowing some things in your life to refine you, but it's to build you up to be ready for something bigger in the future. See, when you face challenges, we need to start looking for the good that can come from it. Several years ago, I was in a really unhealthy relationship at work. This guy and I just would always get into conflict. I mean, it was really frustrating. And multiple times I wanted to quit, to be honest with you. And one of the executives pulled us together into a room, and we began to have this conversation. His hope was that we would hash things out and get on the same page. And he just kept saying things that were just so frustrating and so annoying. And eventually I just lost it. I just stood up and started yelling at him. I mean, I totally lost it. I mean, I hadn't yelled at anyone quite like that since I was like a teenager, yelling at my little brother or something. And finally, when my little tantrum was over, before I even had a chance to feel embarrassed, he says, "Finally, now I know you care." And I thought to myself, oh, he was provoking me. He wanted me to lose it. It was so frustrating. And I remember just a couple days later talking through this experience with one of my running partners in my life group. And I'll never forget, he asked me, "Why do you think he triggers you so much?" It's like, I don't want to talk about my response. I want to talk about the jerk that guy is. But it sent me down this road of reflection. Why was I triggered so much? Why did I start acting like that? And I began to realize that he was poking a wound that had never been healed. A wound that I could trace through different people in my life all the way back to childhood. And so I began to pray a different kind of prayer. Instead of, "God, smite him, take him away from me," I began to pray, "God, would you show me what I need to learn from him? Would you show me what I need to learn from this situation?" It led me down a road of really taking recovery here at Gateway seriously. See, recovery is not just for those who struggle with alcohol and drugs. It's also for those of us who have wounds, bad habits, and hang-ups we want to overcome. It really sent me down a road of healing. And eventually, the two of us are now friends. We'll talk, we'll text, as if that moment never happened. See, you and I, we have wounds, and sometimes the people we're with now end up pressing on those wounds, even unintentionally, or sometimes on purpose. But we can find healing in that. Viktor Frankl suffered through the evils of the Holocaust. He was a neurologist, psychiatrist, philosopher, and author. And listen to what he said. "Everything can be taken from a man but one thing, the last of human freedoms, to choose one's attitude in any given set of circumstances, to choose one's own way." He also said this: "When we are no longer able to change the situation, we are challenged to change ourselves." What a remarkable perspective for someone who suffered so much. And a more recent book dealing with corporate life called Extreme Ownership, Jocko Willink talks about leading up the chain. He talks about those of us who have leaders in our life, people in authority over us. In order for us to become a good leader, we need to communicate what needs we have. We need to push that up the chain of command. He says this in his very blunt former Navy SEAL style: "If your boss isn't making a decision in a timely manner or providing necessary support for you and your team, don't blame the boss. First, blame yourself. Examine what you can do to better convey the critical information for decisions to be made and support allocated." See, we need to take responsibility for our relationships. Not only do we need to look for the good that can come out of a bad situation, but start looking for the good even in a bad leader, the good that we might be able to find even in a bad employee. More than likely, they're just doing the best that they can with the resources that they have. There may be many distressing circumstances, even unjust situations, much like Joseph experienced. But as we can learn from Joseph's life, when we remain faithful and accepting that God is ultimately in charge, we can be confident that God will bring us through those difficult times and reward our faithfulness with time. I mean, who would have blamed Joseph if, when his brothers turned up, he didn't take revenge? But instead, he showed mercy. See, God desires that we exercise mercy above all other sacrifices. Joseph's story also presents amazing insight into how God sovereignly works to overcome evil and bring about his plan. See, after all his ordeals, Joseph was able to see God's hand at work. So his brothers show up, and eventually, after testing them to see if their hearts had changed, maybe even to determine whether or not they still want to kill him, eventually he reveals his identity to them. And listen to what he describes their sin as. "Do not be distressed, and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. It was not you who sent me here, but God." And then this, in Genesis 50, he later reassured his brothers, offering forgiveness, saying, "You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good." See, there are people whose intentions are to harm you, but God can bring good out of that, and he is with you in the midst of that. Well, number four, choose to forgive. Forgiveness is a powerful choice that we can make. When we choose forgiveness, we can then move towards healing and reconciliation, but not until then. But what does it mean to forgive? I found this incredibly helpful. It's from Tim Mackey's podcast called Exploring My Strange Bible. He describes what forgiveness is not. According to Matthew 18, when Jesus describes forgiveness and reconciliation, he describes forgiveness is not ignoring or forgetting. Forgiveness is not condoning or excusing. It's not tolerating or allowing further abuse. It's not reconciliation or restoration. That's another step. It's not returning back to the way things were before. It's not allowing the offender to escape consequences. You see, Jesus walks through this process that if you've been hurt, then you go to that person, and if they respond well, they might be embarrassed and didn't even know they did that. But if they don't respond well, then you take someone else that cares for you, that's there to protect you. You never have to be alone with that person if they're not safe. And then if that doesn't work, you bring leadership in and get them involved. You see, there's a process to protect us, but also to bring healing. Now, let me just acknowledge, some of us have been sexually, physically, or emotionally abused. And if that is you, and it still haunts you, I want to encourage you to get help. In the midst of that, God mourns with those who mourn. He did not want that for you. But he can also bring healing and even bring justice. If you're currently in a situation where you are not safe, we want to help you out of that. Our prayer team, our pastoral staff is here to help you. And whether it's something that happened in the past that still haunts you, or if it's happening right now, you need to get help. If it's happening at work, go to the human resources. Go to your boss's boss. Take the risk. You might be protecting others from the same sort of experience that you're having. But in the process, when we do this, we need to realize that it's an act of maturity asking for help. See, not forgiving them actually hurts us. You may be thinking, but you don't understand. The people that have hurt me don't deserve to be forgiven. It's not about what they deserve. See, forgiveness is releasing the bitterness and the hold that they have on you. Forgiving them does not mean you become a doormat. It does not mean there are no consequences. Forgiveness is for us, not for them. A modern-day Joseph who went from prison to president, Nelson Mandela, once said this: "Resentment is like drinking poison and hoping it poisons the person who hurt you." See, when you forgive, you're actually entrusting that person to God, that God will bring justice. You're not taking revenge. You're entrusting that person to the authorities in your life and to God. And when we do that, God can actually release us from the shame or pain or false guilt or blame that for some reason we carry, even though it was not the choice of ours to make. Now, forgiveness is not just for those most evil things in our life. As followers of Jesus, if you follow him, it's countercultural, but you're supposed to be giving forgiveness all the time. It's a way of life. And it keeps bitterness from coming into our hearts. Bitterness in our marriages, at work, with our siblings, extended family. See, we experience God's kindness and grace and forgiveness, and so we extend that kindness and grace and forgiveness to others. When my daughter Trevi was in middle school, we were talking about a friend of hers who kept taking shots at her. There's a picture of her. That's not the friend. That's her best friend and I, and they're still doing great all these years later. But this other friend just kept picking on her, just kind of taking shots at her. And Trevi asked me, how many times do I have to forgive her? And I reminded her, oh, there's actually a conversation with Jesus about this in the Bible. Do you know how many times Jesus said that we should forgive? And she said, oh, I know, to infinity and beyond. That's not exactly what Jesus said. That was Buzz Lightyear, actually, she's quoting there. But here's the actual conversation between Peter and Jesus. Peter comes to Jesus and asks, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to 7 times? Jesus answered, I tell you, not 7 times, but 77 times. See, Peter was trying to impress Jesus. In their culture, it was kind of common knowledge to just forgive 3 times and then forget it. 3 strikes and you're out. So Peter felt like he was being generous. What if we forgive twice what culture says and add 1 more to get to that lucky number 7? Isn't that generous of me, Jesus? And Jesus says, no, you don't understand. See, Peter was limited to the understanding of the limits of the law. But Jesus wants us to think in terms of the unlimited limits of grace. He says, no, it's not 7 times, it's 77 times. Some translations say 70 times 7. Either one says the same thing. We should forgive way more than we want to. We should be willing to forgive. See, and some people continue to hurt us repeatedly, and we still need to forgive. We may need to want to reframe that relationship. We may want to walk through Matthew 18 with them to protect ourselves. But other people hurt us so badly in the past that just the memory of that painful moment will require us to forgive them again. As a newlywed years ago, I heard something that really helped me. This person said that the goal of marriage is not to avoid fights. The goal is to learn to fight fairly. See, what that means is it's okay that you have disagreement, but in the midst of the disagreement, you need to work through it and come to an agreement together without harboring bitterness. See, some of us have worked through our challenges, and the next thing you know, when something else pops up, we add to it all the other offenses from all the previous years, and suddenly, this person is unforgivable. We see it as a pattern that they can never overcome. But if you're walking with Jesus, all things are possible. He can give you the power to forgive, and he can give the people in your life the opportunity to transform. See, this journey that we're invited on is a journey of forgiveness. It's countercultural. The culture teaches revenge at all costs. But we need to come to an agreement without the bitterness. See, bitterness in our hearts creates doubt in our mind. And when that happens, we take the brokenness from one relationship to the next, from one church to the next, from one job to the next, from one city to the next. Bitterness can haunt us. Listen to what Neil Anderson, the author of The Bondage Breaker, says. As long as we hang on to bitterness against anyone, it affects others close to us who had nothing to do with the pain. See, the problem is we build a wall around our heart to protect us from people who hurt us. But in doing so, we no longer have access to the same love that we actually desperately need. The more we grow to trust God, the more we can navigate a world filled with untrustworthy people, knowing that he can bring healing when they hurt us and that he's holding on to us through the pain. He can bring good out of challenging circumstances. You know, earlier we sang a song and the lyrics were, "You're never gonna let me down." It doesn't mean we won't be faced with disappointment. I like to think of it as like a child being held by the father. He's never going to let you down. He's holding you through the difficulties. Number 5, finally, work towards reconciliation. As followers of Jesus, how we treat others is one of the greatest witnesses that there is something different about us. If forgiveness is a spiritual activity, reconciliation is a supernatural activity. The scriptures tell us in Romans 12, if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. I love this passage because ultimately it says, be personally responsible for your part in every single relationship. But it also reminds us we cannot make them forgive us. We cannot make them reconcile. We can only do our part. In some of your broken relationships, have you done everything, as far as it depends on you, to live at peace with them? See, when there is hurt or confusion or miscommunication, lean into the relationship. Don't run away. Too often we run away from the very thing we need. In a fantastic book called Building a Multi-Ethnic Church, Derwin Gray writes these words. To love someone means to assume their pain, to embrace their story, to invite them into your family so much that it costs you something. Even though there is hostility, only love can defeat hate. See, we can extend the life-giving love of Jesus wherever we go, wherever we live, wherever we work, to those over us and to those working for us. Everywhere we go, God is with us. In fact, a quick tease, July 4th weekend, we're going to try something at Gateway we've never done before. And Carlos will talk more about it next week. But let me just give you a quick little heads up. We're calling it, the church has left the building. More details to come. You see, wherever we are, we represent God in those places. And he is with us. Even when we're suffering, we need to remember God does not forsake his children. Genesis story in 39 says over and over and over, in spite of all that he was facing, the Lord was with Joseph. You need to know the Lord is with you. He's holding you. He's guiding you through this. He can bring good from this, but it requires surrendering everything to him. So quick overview. I want you just to consider, just an honest assessment. Are there any of these that need work? Do you remember why you're there? Are you redefining success according to God or getting sucked into the definition according to the world? Are you seeking to find the good? Are you choosing to forgive? Are you working towards reconciliation? I want you to consider that. I want to pray for us, and then we're going to have a song that reminds us. It could even be a prayer that from your heart that God can heal you. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you that you are so good, that you came to rescue us, that you willingly gave your life, dying on the cross, defeating death by rising from the dead on the third day. And you give us your spirit when we say, I need you. Forgive me. God, may we do that, not just for the first time, but every single day throughout the day, in our homes, where we work, in our neighborhoods. God, that we would allow you to heal our heart, to bind up our brokenness. God, help us to surrender our pain, our bitterness, our frustration, that you can bring healing and use us as healers in our broken world. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
You might find, look a little deeper, you might uncover a shadow side in my wicked ways, my selfish heart on my sinful day. Oh, you might not like what you're about to see, yeah. I need you to heal my heart. I need you to hear.
So I got to ask you guys, what is your next step? As you might know, we always like to ask, what is your next step in response to what we have just talked about? If you're new here to Gateway, we would love to meet you. If you're here in the room, then I would like to meet you out at one of our new here tables. We have a special gift for you, just saying welcome to Gateway. But if you're watching online, be sure to go to gatewaychurch.com/connect. Maybe you've called Gateway Church your home for a while, but you're not quite connected yet. We have so many areas that you can get connected to our family here at Gateway. Again, you can go to gatewaychurch.com/connect. You know, if you're a person here at Gateway and you've become familiar with our church, then we are a very generous community. And as we are participating in so many different things around the world and here locally in Austin, we would encourage you to give. Again, if you're a guest, though, don't feel any pressure to give, but there are some instructions on the screen behind me and on your screen in front of you if you're watching online. And then as you guys heard in Eric's message, he talked about talking with a pastor or talking with somebody here, maybe for prayer or to just have a conversation about the things that you are going through. There are people here online that would love to pray with you, but also here in person, talk to anybody with a staff lanyard, and we'd love a chance to pray with you. Next Sunday is Father's Day, so moms in the room. The dads really helped you guys out to celebrate Mother's Day, but moms in the room, take a note to send in funny pictures of your dad or maybe the father of your kids to celebrate them next Sunday for Father's Day. And next week, we're continuing in our series, Trust Me If You Can, and we're talking about relationships, and we'd love to see you here. Y'all have a great Sunday. Thanks for coming out.